The first speaker is Timo Dickscheid from Jülich, and he's a computer scientist and will speak about towards automated mapping of areas using deep learning. So Timo, the floor is yours.
Thanks a lot, Katrin. So I will talk about our endeavor of mapping cytoarchitectonic areas in the big brain and in other brains based on microscopic scans of tissue sections, which is a core part of HiBall, so to say. So the using deep learning, and the basis for all of this, you have certainly seen similar pictures. Just to start it off, is that we are cutting postmodern brains into thousands of sections that are mounted on glass slides, and we keep them in our institutes in large rooms, as you can see here. And we investigate these individual sections for brain structure. In particular, what we want to do here is we want to build a multi-level brain atlas that is based on cytoarchitectonic regions definitions. And what this means, you can see it on this first slide. On the left, we have two snippets from a microscopic scan from two different brain areas in the visual system. And you can see, most of you already know it anyway, that the patterns of the cells, of the neuronal cells that we see here, they build different distributions in space. They build out layers. We will hear more about cortical layers today. And they have different sizes and different densities. And this type of spatial distributions, they basically define cytoarchitectonic areas. And these cytoarchitectonic areas are an indicator for functional modules, and they are a very good basis to compare different modalities in the brain and to localize different modalities in the brain, because they indicate a certain architecture of these brain areas. And the classical way of doing this is that a neuroscientist takes out individual sections, localizes roughly the area where a transition between two areas could be located, and then there is a semi-automatic workflow that would confirm. Here on the right, you see this white profile. This algorithm would confirm that there is indeed a significant change in this spatial arrangement, and so it confirms a border between two neighboring cytoarchitectonic areas. And this means that we can, that the neuroscientist, the neuroanatomist, can basically map such borders in two-dimensional sections. And this is what we are doing for many, many years in Jülich, in the Institute of Katrin Amunds. The problem is that if you look at different brains, we see that the location and the particular shape of these different cytoarchitectonic areas is very, very different. So you see here 10 different human brains, and you see the delineations of cortical areas mapped into a 1 millimeter space of these brains. You see how different the shape is, how strong the variability is in the different individuals. And what we are doing for many years is to delineate areas in at least 10 individual brains, then reconstruct a representation in 3D, as you see in the middle, and merge these different maps in the different individuals into a common space, the MNI space, to see a probabilistic distribution of this area that captures this variability in the different individuals. Now, this is really a lot of work. A human anatomist can only map some sections in each of these brains. So in the order of maybe every 100th section is feasible, and still it is a project of typically a year or more to map these area, one area in different brains. So this is really, really a hard process. And we have these probabilistic maps at a resolution of 1 millimeter, since we don't have these maps in every section of the brain. And what we are now about to do in HiBall and in the European Human Brain Project, we We want to build a multi-level atlas that has these Saito architectonic areas as a basis that also integrates other modalities like architecture of fibers or functional parcellations, and that captures the variability as we have just seen it in probabilistic maps. But we want to extend this across the scales using the big brain model that we are today here to discuss a lot, and combine it with the full microscopic scale in 3D, where we can see individual cortical layers, where we can see the individual cells and all this detail in the big brain model, and in the future, hopefully also in extended models. This is what we are setting out to do. But this requires us for the big brain model to map these areas in really every single section. This means for some areas in thousands of sections, and we want to do this also in other brains. And this is not any more feasible for a human scientist to do. So we need here really the help of high throughput imaging technology to digitize all this material. We need the help of machine learning, image processing, and also high performance computing to do these computations. And we need neuroinformatics to provide such data at these high resolutions to the community. This is what we are setting out to do. And I'm now talking about how we use deep learning to accelerate and increase the degree of automation in Saito architectonic mapping. And this is a quite difficult task if you look at these examples here. So these are all patches of the cortex depicted in microscopic sections. And you can see how different these textures are. These are not all different areas. Some are different, but you see that we have curvature differences. We have sometimes oblique sections, so you don't see these layers that I mentioned earlier. We have histological artifacts, and it is quite difficult to tell which area you see here. But we want to have machine learning algorithms learn to distinguish these textures and reliably say which areas we see here, so that we can apply it to all histological sections that we are scanning, and not only to 3D volumes like the big brain, also to new brains that we are scanning where we don't yet have a 3D model available. And we have set out to do this from 2016. This was a work of Hannah Spitzer, like the following slides as well. I think she is in the call here and she could just take over now. She has done much of the pioneering work here. So we trained a UNet, which is a standard a deep learning network for biomedical image segmentation. We modified it a bit and tried to learn from existing expert annotations how to do these segmentations. This was a multi-area segmentation network where we focused on the visual system. And as you can see on the right, the system learned somehow to do it, but it was not quite performing very well. It actually could distinguish the primary visual cortex quite well in many sections, but in sections with a bit of a strange staining or not so standard staining, it was already having difficulties. 1 year later, we modified this network and we introduced a prior that gave some information from the probabilistic maps, a very weak information where an area would be roughly expected. And this stabilized the network quite a bit, as you can see here, but not to the degree that we could use it for fully automated mapping. Then we took a completely different route. We basically stepped back from the task of image segmentation and just looked at a so-called self-supervised task. We created a Siamese network where we have basically the possibility to feed in two image patches at a time, going through the same network branches with shared weights. And we just asked the network to learn to determine the distance across the brain surface for these two patches. And this we could do with many, many, many image patches from the big brain, thanks to the 3D reconstruction that we have access to. And interestingly enough, the network learned quite well to predict these distances. So that was quite remarkable how well that worked. And our hypothesis was that to solve this task of predicting the distances, the network has to understand something about Saito architecture. Otherwise, it is more or less infeasible to solve this task. And what you see on the right here in my slides is that there is an internal feature representation that the deep network learned that was used to predict this distance here in yellow. And we were also very interested, what was it that the network actually learned? Is this actually an interesting encoding of cytoarchitectonic properties? So we clustered these features and just had a look if they form meaningful clusters in the 3D space. And indeed, as you can see here on this image, these features clustered into quite meaningful areas. We could see here quite nicely some of the principal sulci, and we could also see some of the lobes of the brain. Only by clustering these internal features that have a much lower dimension than the original image patches. So it seemed that the network has learned something. But we went even further in the institute. I'm stepping one slide forward. And it's Kai Kiewicz, who will also talk in the lightning talks later on. He actually looked at all the filters that the network has learned to see what is it actually that the network is interested in. And we found a remarkable range of features that also a neuroanatomist would use. There were rules like density in different cortical layers and things like this that the network has actually learned to employ. So it is actually, we have high confidence that these networks have learned meaningful internal feature representations. Now coming back to the segmentation task, we basically use this pre-training, this self-supervised task for the Siamese network to initialize the original network that would do the multi-area segmentation. And in fact, this improved the results by a margin. So here you see again the same images in the visual system, and we have a quite nice segmentation now in both of the different sections and in many others for sure of the different visual areas. So this self-supervised task where the network could see a lot of image data helped a lot to train these networks. In the last year mostly, we focused now on making these CNNs practically useful for continuing to map the big brain. And here we have to go back into the 1 micron sections because the big brain currently has a resolution of 20 micron, which does not allow to in detail to identify the borders of cytoarchitectonic areas. So we leverage now these networks to help a neuroanatomist to do the mapping. In principle, a neuroanatomist will map a few areas with 100 or more sections in between, and the network will be trained to map this particular area in all the remaining sections. And this works quite nicely. Christian Schiffer is doing this work. You see here on the right, area V1, which has been mapped across almost 2,400 sections. This is a movie that I very quickly put together, where you see how many sections and how different these sections are had to be processed. And what we get as a result, this is actually a movie, it should be rotating, but it doesn't, is now the first 3D maps in the big brain of very high detail of cortical cytoarchitectonic areas in the visual system, fully mapped in the big brain. So we have quite some success now since a few years to use deep learning for mapping big brain and for mapping more tissue data. So what are we going to do next? We want to use these tools basically to map the whole big brain. So to go from area to area, use this enlarged degree of automation to map the big brain. But in HiBall, what we also want to do is we want to develop transfer learning methods so that we can propagate these maps more easily to new brain samples where we have all the sections available. So this is something we are going to do in the next years. And we are also doing research to improve the learning strategies because we actually still have the ambition to build a general multi-area segmentation model that would be able to segment all cytoarchitectonic areas in the brain. We do not know if this will be possible, but we are rather optimistic. And so we are looking out for deep learning strategies that would allow such a highly complex network and such a helpful resource for doing all this mapping. And that's the end of my talk. Thank you.